Thank you, Alison, for organising the event. My name is Roger Whittle, head of Westwood School, but responsible for Partnership Plus. And that's about the importance of me, because tonight it's all about the teacher and Andy Swallow, who will do the lesson observation for us. So I'm going to pass over immediately to Alison.
Yes, I just want to say welcome to Nicholas Chamberlaine, our new Associate Head Teacher. It's great to see so many of you here. We weren't anticipating so many because we know how long it takes to get here, but it's absolutely fantastic to see you. So we're going to start straight away. So I know that you'll be quite happy to get home on time.
Thank you, Alison. I don't know if... Can you hear me, ladies and gentlemen? Can you hear me in the back or not? Prefer it with the mic.
Yep, okay. Just a couple of remarks before we get underway. Delighted to be back in Warwickshire again. Andy Swallow, significant experience of inspecting schools, and today we're not inspecting schools, but we're talking about teaching and learning, which is very dear to my heart. Just a couple of reminders. One, of course, that we should have no preconceived ideas of pedagogy, strategy, approach, whatever. And I haven't. I've blown my mind about what I think might be effective practice, what might not be effective practice, how this experience might start, how it might round up. I absolutely am blank. But I'm focused on three things, and I've got three questions in my mind, and they're these. One, in the next sort of 35, 40 minutes-ish, what's going to change? What's changed, or what's changing? Because this change won't be completed tonight. Learning goes on, doesn't it? We're just seeing a snapshot of a learning experience. But what's changing, for how many of these young people? And I think we've got about 24, a high attaining year 11 group, and by how much? Those are the three questions, ladies and gentlemen. What's changing, for how many, and by how much? I'll be privileged, because I'm going to be weaving in and out of here to see what the learners are writing, how they're responding, what they're saying to each other, what they're saying to teacher. We've got the teacher mic'd up, so we ought to be able to pick up teacher talk and hopefully some learner discussion as well. But at the end of the experience, I'll be able to fill in the gaps for you. But I'm hopeful that I'll be able to get you to interact with me in terms of looking at the episodes of the learning, yeah, not just the activities, but the actual experiences and the extent to which these experiences actually challenge children's thinking. If students are interested, if students are challenged, regardless of their ability, then they should achieve. So, let's see what we've got in store. We're absolutely grateful to Hanif and his Year 11 students, and without any more to do, remember those three questions: what's changing, for how many, and by how much. Thank you.
Have a read through. What skills? There are three particular methods I'm looking for. For each one, I want you to think about what skills. Why use them? Why are they useful? What are their limitations? So just have a think about that. Just give you a little bit of time on that. Right, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring this together. Like I said, we're in a boxing match, okay? Jacket comes off, sleeves up. Right, we're ready for the training. Now, I want you to have a read of that. I want you to engage with that, because I'm going to tell you where we're going to get to in the next half an hour to 35 minutes, what we're going to try and get through, okay? So if you read that to yourselves, see what it means to you. Eat it, enjoy it, hug it. It's yours. It's not only the main three points up there that we're going to get through, but the bottom points are the skills. The training. Okay, let's open this up, okay? Because I've got to say, tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we've got some ugly opponents. So we need to be ready for them. We need to get in their minds, okay? Okay, the three methods. Let's see. Molly, give me one of them. Graphical. Good. Okay, like it. Let's see. Obi, another. Substitution method. Okay, thank you very much. Let's see. Theo? Illumination. Okay, there's three methods there. Okay, thank you. Right. Now think about the skills involved with those. Graphical method. I like it, but it's got a bit of a limitation. Let's see, have a think about what limitation does the graphical method have? Callum, what do you reckon?
If the equations to geodesic places, the line on the graph.
Okay, the line on the graph might not be very accurate to read off the points. Okay, we might need a bit of clarification on that. Does anybody want to add to that? Karen Creek, do you want to add to the limitation of a graphical method? Here's another linear. they cross at one point, so they're going to give you one solution. Okay, what sorts of functions are going to give you two solutions? Have a think about this. Francis, what two functions will give you two solutions?
Quadratic and a linear.
Right, good one. Okay, let's see. I'm just having a quick look around the room. Right, Travis, what does a quadratic graph look like? What does the function look like? A what? Okay, what is that? A parabola. Okay? Ellie, you knew I was going to pick you, didn't you? Right. As soon as Travis says the word quadratic, Ellie knows it's a parabola. Ellie, can you share with us how you remember the word parabola?
The Muppet song.
The Muppet song. Yeah. Give us a rendition.
Parabola.
I'll finish it off. Parabola. Parabola. Anyway, I won't give you any more of that, okay? Good way of remembering it. So, what we're going to do is think about simultaneous equations and the skills. What sort of skills do you need to actually solve simultaneous equations? Like, let's just quick fire. Any sorts of algebraic skills? Rearranging formula. Anything here? Factorising, like it. Expanding brackets. Gosh, they're going to do really well. From back tables. Quadratic formula. Whoa, Daniel. Whoa, right, quadratic formula. Does anybody remember the quadratic formula? Okay, that's one. Anybody else? Oh, Katie, you're looking it up. Good. Do you need to remember the quadratic formula? Why? It's actually in the exam paper on the front page. Do you need to know how to use it? Okay? Right, so we've taken that to part of it. And those are the strategies and the skills you gave me. Right, cracking stuff. Now, ladies and gentlemen, like I said, we've got some opponents. On your table, you'll find this sheet. There are 8 ugly opponents on there. I don't want you to solve them. I want you just to write next to each opponent what method or strategy you're going to use, and maybe in the other column, just note down any skills. Okay? Right, I'm going to give you a few minutes for this, because this is part of the training for the fight. We're not in the fight yet. You're trying to get into their mind, okay? You've got a plan to try and knock out your opponent. Share. Talk to each other. Don't worry. Share with each other. Share. Okay, yeah. Chamberlaine have put in green with us. There might be more than one strategy. Okay, so I think about that challenge. Alright? Okay, how are we getting up here? Good. Okay. Elimination, substitution, elimination. I can see we're all a bit adverse to graphical at the moment. What's graphical ever done to you? Remember, you're trying to get into the minds of your opponent. What strategy are you going to use to knock them out? What skills do you need to know? Okay, year 11. I'm just cutting this short because the fight has to start soon. Okay? What I've enjoyed is having a look around and see what you've written down. Some of you are really thinking about not only the method, but what's inside the method. What are the skills you need? Because remember, those are the skills you need at a higher level. Okay? Now, I lost my clicker. Here it is. Right. Okay. Here's the rumble in the jungle. Right. Now, you'll see on that sheet, I've labeled questions at lightweight, middleweight, heavyweight. Right. All these questions are your opponents. For a knockout, you need to check your solutions are correct. Let me see. Who haven't I? Sophia. How do I know if my solutions are correct or not? substitute it back in?
Yes.
Okay. After a knockout, I want you to pick an opponent that's going to be tougher, uglier, and a heavier weight. But be aware, behind your sheet is a super heavyweight. But don't look at it yet. Now, this is what I'd like you to do, ladies and gentlemen. I want you to think about a starting point. Are you going to go for the lightweight, the middleweight, or heavyweight? Where are you going to get stuck in? Theo, where do you reckon?
Who are you going to get stuck first?
Thank you.
So once you've done the similar one, same way. carbonated copies. I want you to tell me which weight can you fight at, and which weight can you fight at today. And I want you to be honest on here as well. What further help do you need from me? But importantly, is what do you need to do, your next steps? So Daniel, remember, expanding brackets is a big priority for you, isn't it? Yeah? Okay? Right? Shan, the language, the terminology. Think about that, okay? Right? Good. But it's got to be personal to you. What are your next steps? Don't make them woolly, like, I'm going to work harder on this. That doesn't mean anything. Give me detail. Once you've honestly completed that, what I want you to do is you keep the top copy in your book, and I will have the yellow copy. So I need to know what I need to do. So we've both got jobs to take home with us. But be honest. If you wish, year 11, because I'm just keeping an eye on time as well. If you wanted to give me my copy on Thursday when we see each other again, that's fine, so you can have some more thinking time about it at home. The last thing I want you to do is rush this, because these next steps is what's important to you and what's important to me. Okay? Right. But if you have finished, leave me the yellow copy.
Ladies and gentlemen, can you put your hands together for Hannah and Mary Wilson? Starting points, because of course we've got a big
choice agenda here. And that's about 17 minutes. So around about 17 minutes to link back to prior learning, to set the scene, and around 16 minutes of action. About 16 minutes of learning experience, and a roundup of about 3 or 4 minutes in terms of self-evaluation and so forth. 37 minutes experience. We're going to judge the experience, we're going to judge what we've seen. This is not inspection, this is day-to-day, typical, hopefully, teaching and learning. Had it been an inspection, I wouldn't have stayed 37 minutes, probably, you might be thinking that. I would certainly have stayed up to 30 minutes-ish. So I would have seen around about, I would certainly have seen at least two-thirds of the learning experience, probably a little more, probably about three-quarters of that learning experience. I wouldn't have seen the self-reflection bit. Come back to that in a few moments' time. So hopefully that's what you recall of the actual experience. And let's share some thoughts together now. And if you will, interact with me. I'll try and pick out what you're saying and share it with the rest of the audience in terms of some of the key questions about effectiveness of those learning episodes and how they actually build. But just a little bit about the books, first of all. This is not new, quite clearly, in terms of simultaneous equations. It's not necessarily totally embedded. Certainly the three approaches are in their books, and they've clearly gone through the methodology, but in a rather repetitive, I think, which is positive, rather sort of controlled, modelled way. So it looks as though they've been certainly introduced to the methodology, the critical skills. There's certainly signs in their books of response, but not a degree of open-ended application, which I think is what we've seen today. So in terms of the learning journey, these students aren't at the point of gathering information. They've got most of the information they need. They're not necessarily at the point, all of them, of processing, absorbing for the first time, although there's a fair amount of, I think, processing, absorbing still going on. But I think we've caught them at the point, at the first point, really, where they've been invited in a fairly open-ended manner to apply. So we'll talk in a minute too about how effective that experience has been. So let's just consider just those first 3 or 4 minutes, really, and anything that you want to share with me, put a hand up, just give me a call. Just those first 3 or 4 minutes, the music's on. Okay, we've got a context. Not really bothered about a context necessarily, but we've got a boxing context. Fine, if there hasn't been a context, equally fine, but interesting the extent to which that context enhances the learning, or hinders the learning, or is just there as an interest. Get your views on that in a second or two. And those 2 or 3 subsequent minutes as they're sitting down, as they're getting the gear out, just to think about the three methods, the skills, and just generally what we're picking up from that early 3-4 minutes about their attitudes to learning. And I know Ofsted's big on attitudes to learning, and we'll unpick some of the things that are going through my mind in those first 3 or 4 minutes about what I'm trying to piece together, having been able to, very early on, before they get stuck in, look at their books as well, in terms of the learning attitudes. Any comments on just those first 3 or 4 minutes? Just, feel free to interact positively, negatively, whatever, as a start to learning. Any points? What do you think? Come on, somebody get the ball rolling. Positive start to learning, 3 or 4 minutes? Negative start, what do we think? Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite purposeful. And obviously some routine there that was
Okay, thank you. Purposeful, you think you're right. You're seeing a routine there in terms of learners who don't take long to get to grips, invited to think and respond, okay? Despite the fact there's 150 people watching in a contrived scenario. Okay, yeah. Any other thoughts, ladies and gentlemen, about those first 3-4 minutes? I'll give you my thoughts as we go through. Your thoughts first. Yeah. Okay, so the music's setting a tone, expectation, there's going to be hard maths, but we're going to get there. Like we sort of say, it's hard maths, but we're going to have fun at the same time, don't know. Yeah, okay, thank you. Any other points, ladies and gentlemen? But just these first 3 or 4 minutes is a start to learn. Any other points? Let me tell you what I'm thinking then, because it's interesting that recent HMI research in terms of teaching and learning finds that some of the least effective episodes in learning are the initial ones. In other words, you know, that first sort of 8, 9, 10, 11 minutes kind of thing of a learning experience. Generalised, I realise. But in terms of this first 2 or 3 minutes, what are we looking for really? Well, I'm looking for, as I said, attitudes. I'm looking for learners showing interest, learners being switched on, learners wanting to be there, and yeah, the music and the boxing scenario, there's an IWB slide behind, it's not this one of course, but the initial one, yeah, possibly arouses a bit of curiosity in some of the learners. It certainly probably relaxes them a bit. They may have come from history, geography, PE, whatever, and I don't think it is over. Intervention, I don't think it's over kill. And interestingly, what I'm more concerned about now, what I'm more focused on now, is the extent to which all 24 take advantage of that 2 or 3 minutes to reflect and think about methodology. Some of them looking back in their books, some of them actually starting to talk, albeit at an early stage with each other. And the extent to which we've got through their eyes, their body posture, that initial talk, real concentration and focus. I thought we'd got that. You know, within 3 or 4 minutes, they've arrived, they're out of PE, they're out of history, they're out of graphics, they're in maths. And I just thought the swiftness of that connection, they know where to look in their books for any notes they need, talking right from the word go, just okay, we're in a contrived scenario, we realise, but we can only talk about what we see. And yeah, I think it's a positive start. The colleague that talked about routines, yeah, they seem well established. We'll talk a little bit about ethos and climate as we go through the next 5-6 minutes perhaps. Rapport, general day-to-day routines that have been established. But yeah, first 3 or 4 minutes, positive scenario. Extent to which they're talking, difficult for you to hear, I realise. Extent to which they're thinking about methodology, well, that's going to be surfaced in a moment or two. But certainly in those first 3 or 4 minutes, I couldn't see any learner that wasn't actually focused on either, you know, graphical substitution, can't remember the third one, I'm looking at Annie for
elimination
indeed. And one, you know, within one or the other, and beginning to start to think about those skills, yeah. Learning objectives, learning outcomes shared, only a couple of minutes. Any comments, ladies and gentlemen, just about those learning outcomes, just about those learning objectives, and where we are these days in terms of objective outcomes, because cranky, have we moved over the last 5-6 years? Remember 5-6 years ago when we were sharing them in the first 2 minutes, revising them every 3 minutes? Almost over. Just that 2 minutes. Any thoughts? Straightforward? Yeah.
Just thought there was like a massive word, so I got halfway down
and beyond the thing I've been in. Yeah. Yeah, colleague just saying they thought there was massive words. Danger, you get halfway down, you know, the learners switch off because there's a lot of text there indeed,
And they're all really three fairly straightforward outcomes we were looking for. Yeah, any other thoughts, ladies and gentlemen, about those? Just the way the outcomes have been come right at the beginning, but they're early enough to shape, to inform learners' thinking, so they know where they're heading and they know what it's going to be about, what's expected of them. Any other thoughts? I must agree with you. When I saw the text come up, I felt cranky. You know, death by words here. Didn't necessarily need the full sentences. We could have had a bit of space in. We've got a few skills at the bottom. But I liked the opportunity. I only like things if they're effective. I think we talk about things we like in schooling a lot. We can only like things if we're effective, because if not, then, you know, well, you know, then they're not worth the candle. But I thought it was a really useful opportunity for them to just look at them and take most of those 2 minutes to silently read and think. Don't know what they're thinking, obviously, but I'm looking at their eyes again, I'm looking at the face again, I'm looking to see whether I can pick up signs of pain or, you know, real sort of anxiety, or whether we can see sort of recognition in terms of, yeah, this makes sense. I'm not picking up a lot of pain. I'm certainly seeing eyes that are on the screen. I'm certainly seeing learners that are processing what's required of them. And hopefully that's a half-decent start. But I must admit, you know, let's not nowadays go overkill with too much too soon in terms of, you know, multi-objectives, multi-outcomes, and so forth. Let's make sure we're setting the scene. Learners understand that they're going to be tested and challenged, and these looked to be interesting outcomes, didn't they? If they materialised, because there was certainly progression across them. There was certainly progression in terms of those outcomes, but we'll need to see the proof and put it in a moment or two, from moving from two linear equations, possibly looking at pairs of simultaneous equations, linear and quadratic, and possibly to think about pairs of simultaneous equations, linear plus an equation within a certain form. So yeah, we move on, and we've got now 5-6 minutes, we've set the scene, we've got certainly focus, we've got certainly buy-in, I think, at this stage. And now we've got 4 minutes where we have a bit of question and answer. It'd be interesting to see how many learners, because the question and answer, it's one at a time, can't get everybody in, but directed questions, not hands up, how many learners contributing, just to surface the methodology that they've been considering and some of the skills they'll need to think about. Just that first 3 or 4 minutes, only that first 3 or 4 minutes, they haven't gone to the papers yet to look at the 8 calculations, just that question and answer. Any comments in terms of the effectiveness, just to cement the 3 approaches and some of the skills they might be using? What did you think? Effective? Because it's every episode that builds up that we've got to be looking at. Buying 24 learners, even when one's talking, you know, what are the rest of them doing? How many actually spoke? Can we get a feel for how many were involved at that stage? Yeah.
I just got a feeling there was about 4 or 5 people who were actually involved in that session during the 3 or 4 minutes.
Right.
They benefited from group session or a chance to attach themselves.
Okay. A colleague thinking, not a great deal of participation, probably 3 or 4 learners, possibly more opportunity for them to briefly discuss amongst. Yeah, okay, thank you. Any other thoughts there, ladies and gentlemen, just in terms of beginning to just surface a little bit what they might have been thinking internally? Yeah.
With some of the questioning, it didn't seem to develop the questioning, so why do you think that, or which is the best, like evaluative sort of questioning? It's quite sort of, what's a better word, simplistic questioning,
okay. Just talking about the nature of the questioning, possibly developing the questioning, you know, moving from a response, if they want to add anything there, just deepening the sort of focus a little bit, just 3 or 4 minutes, we're just really connecting back to private learning here, but thank you for that. Any other comments, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah.
I think there was one young lady that sort of couldn't respond to a question, and rather than perhaps exploring that further, sort of then dipped over to a different student.
some interesting points. Thank you for those. I think we've got more response. I sort of had a little running tally because I tend to do with the old class Q&A because I'm always interested in old class Q&A. How long it lasts, what it actually results in, because April Wright, we're asking one question, one person answers, what do you think, and so forth. Is that representative of the collective thinking of the group in terms of what's servicing from one or two individuals? But I got up to certainly 9, 10. I think a poor half of the group, and from all corners really, fed back. Take the points about developing the questioning. I was just wondering, and it's not for me to say, gosh, you should have done this, you should have done that, because no preconceived ideas, remember. But in terms of just getting a little bit more feedback from the students as the teacher, possibly just letting them go, just 60 seconds, 30 seconds, what do you think of that kind of thing, come back to me, just a little bit more perhaps, pair or small group talk, would have certainly given me, and therefore the teacher, more of an idea of what was going on in some of their minds. But, this is a teacher that knows the group well, I think. This is a teacher that's very much in tune with the learning, and, we got some responses which were very productive responses, I have to say. Looking around again at the faces and the eyes, there's certainly a lot of intense listening. The proof will be in the pudding. The proof will be in the pudding now, actually, because they've got an opportunity and 6 minutes, which is a long time, to look at the kind of questions they might be tackling, because these are differentiated. We've certainly got three questions involving largely linear, single-sentence equations, two linears. We've certainly got a setup.
Just blocking, I mentioned that point was just gave
I thought this was an effective experience, this part of the learn, really. You know, I see so many lessons where children are sort of thrown in the deep end, where sometimes it's, you know, it's understandable, isn't it, that teachers sometimes don't dare to wait. You know, we've got to be moving, we've got this awful word in teaching and learning called pace. Let's get rid of pace, let's substitute pace with rhythm, with momentum, with, you know, that building up of understanding. And I thought, in terms of the listening to the learners, I thought the quality of the talk was quite intense. Everybody in the, all 24, to a greater or lesser degree, but peers helping out each other quite effectively, talking about at least two tiers of the problems. Everybody started off looking at the lightweight, the less demanding, if you want, but for some they were certainly demanding calculations. Some went on to the heavyweights, having dipped in slightly to the middleweights, but having recognised a similar approach, and therefore they didn't need to go into it in all that depth. But certainly within 6 minutes, not necessarily did everybody tackle each of the eight, but almost all had a good investigation of almost all of the eight, yeah. And some very good use of mathematical terminology, some interesting debate about, you know, justification, challenge coming out, nobody necessarily accepting what learners were saying initially, and some interesting, as colleagues said over there, some interesting, I thought, initial now interactions between teacher and learners. I just thought this was the first point where I'm sensing climate, where I'm sensing that this teacher is very much in touch with his learners, knows where his learners are, knows what's needed at this stage, but the proof, as I keep saying, the problem will be when we get them into that application phase and the extent to which he assesses, intervenes, or doesn't, for that matter. Yeah. So we're into about, ladies and gentlemen, 15 minutes or so here. We're going to introduce the actual task, which doesn't take much introduction. The key, of course, here is choice. And before we go into the 16 minutes, and we'll glean out the 16 minutes, because this is the real piece de resistance of the 16 minutes, aren't there? Any views at this point, anything going through your mind at this point about choice? So we're not going to talk about the 16 minutes just yet, but now we're tabled, it only takes the teacher about 40, 50 seconds, and I think the learners have calmed on by now, that there's a starting point, and it's not necessarily going to be their end point. Any comments, choice? What were you thinking at this stage? Yeah, thanks, Ross.
I think as long as the choice they make are appropriate, and the perhaps some poor choice they make about them, swept up on the teacher, I think that's a really possible way of helping to move forward and replace somebody else if they need that for a classical start, and be also engaged them because they're doing something they feel comfortable and confident. But I think some of the role of the teacher that makes choices to make sure that there's no poor choices.
Thank you. Colleague just saying here, choice can be a really positive thing because learners obviously coming at the point where they feel the most confident, they feel the most secure. Learners like choice, see very little choice actually in teaching and learning. Learners' diets, learners' agendas, learning agendas, largely dictated by teaching. But absolutely right in pointing out the potential shortfalls, of course, if choice is not challenging enough. And back to that notion of guided choice, and did we see guided choice, and to what extent did we feel that learners were actually starting at the appropriate points, and were they moving on, you know, with sufficient, well, I use the word pace, rapidity, you know, did they need to prove examinations, though, yet, ladies and gentlemen. We're only just in January, and back to the teacher again. Teaching knows what it wants to get out of this moment in time. Might well be moving into learners not being impaired, although your point's well made in terms of everybody having access to A Star questions, A questions. But at this moment in time, thank you for the point. But it's back to what the learners will get out of it at this point. And we bear in mind that by giving them certain choices, then we're not preventing some from moving on to higher order questions or higher order experiences. When they're ready for that. Personally, I think I thought it was the learners enjoyed that notion of choice. What was interesting, the 16 minutes, nobody remained within the same question. Nobody, very few learners actually remained within the same category. Most learners moved from middle to high. Some tackled two high questions, the second one, which was certainly more challenging than the first. And the few learners, and there were few, that started in the lightweight category, certainly moved into the middleweight category. So in terms of actual little challenge and skills, we had a range of skills, we had a range of approaches, and certainly in terms of applying those range of skills and approaches, I think very difficult here because different tables are working, different pairs on tables are working on different calculations at different times. But certainly I don't think that the notion of choice in that 16 minutes necessarily held anybody back. And that's where we come now to listening to them talk and looking at what they're producing and listening carefully to teacher interaction. I welcome your comments on the teaching at this point, because too often when learners are empowered and released, teaching doesn't necessarily come into its forefront. And what we don't want to see are teachers sort of sitting on the shoulders of learners and almost impairing the thinking or hindering the thinking. And sometimes assessment's really effective, I think, when you're looking at a teacher and they're listening and they're looking, or they make a decision not to do anything at that point and move on, or just simply leave a question or leave a remark to sort of fester and come back later. Too often, some teachers hinder really the depth of the learning because there's too much intervention too soon, which reduces the pain. And ladies and gentlemen, that's become my favourite word at the moment. It's not an offset word, more fun in the offset handbook, but I want to see learners in pain. I want to look at these learners and look at their faces and listen to their talk to see how much they're being tested here, or whether or not the choice they've made, or indeed because one learner is taking a more dominant role than the other, it's a bit of an easy ride. So what do you think, ladies and gentlemen, about this 15, 16 minutes in terms of what you could hear or in terms of what you could see, in terms of the interactions, what the teaching was doing? Any comments here about how you thought, this about the effectiveness of this 15, 16 minutes? Because it's a long time here for learners to apply and to maintain concentration, focus, and to really dig deep to search out some of those skills and test them out to the full. Any comments?
Certainly.
student here who were getting quite impatient because they couldn't get something and peers interacting and so forth to move the learning forwards. Yeah, okay, any other points, gentlemen? What did it seem like to you? What did the learners' attitudes appear like? Did you think we were in the day? Did we, was the body posture, was the eyes, was the just like their general demeanour telling you that, you know, this was pretty straightforward, so that they were pretty engrossed, it was pretty intense. What do you think? Colleague just said it would be invaluable to add a progress check that sometime in the 15-16 minutes in terms of teacher getting from the learners, are you being paid, etc. It might have been, you might argue, because the teacher was moving around, he actually knew, because I guess I'm looking for any affirmation from you about, you know, where he went during those 15-16 minutes. Was it largely spent here? Was it largely spent over there? Did he visit most of the learners? Do you think he was picking up the vibes? Was there, you know, necessary that sort of whole class recap, recall, how's it going for you kind of thing, break? Or, you know, was the learning actually flowing and was the teacher totally in tune with the learning? Does that make sense? Anybody got any responses to sort of that hypothesis? Yeah.
I think by and large that the teacher was in tune with what the class was doing and what Gary had said to students. 15, 16 minutes for a task that large, it was a minimum amount of time to it, rather a long amount of time, surely.
Thank you. Colleagues saying that he felt that the teacher was in touch, not necessarily did he need, because, you know, some of that was his time. The teacher and learners, that check. And an observation that 15, 16 minutes might have been the minimum on this kind of experience, not a long time. I just know some classes that have been let go 15, 16 minutes and being in the car park. I appreciate your comments, because if you've really got learners who are banging in and they're really, you know, intense about the learning and development of the application of skills, I agree with it. I mean, the key thing was when he stopped them, there looked to be a whole sort of sense of relief. Were they all sort of gagging for a break? Were they sort of like they had enough? Or did it look as though if they'd let them go another 10 minutes, they'd continued? Have they got the ever-ready batteries in? What do you reckon? Colleagues nodding? I mean, what do you think? Would they have gone another 5-10 minutes? I think so. I'm with you. I think so. Yeah? Colleague at the back. How did you know? What was telling you was you're right over there. Right. How did you pick up that challenge, that stretch? Lots of actually guidance to move on, if you noticed. Lots of guidance going, you don't want now, move on. Why don't we try the heavyweights? There's not a lot of opportunity here, I didn't think, for learners to sort of get their heads under the table kind of thing, get their heads down and coast. Not at all. If they weren't ready to move on and challenge themselves, or if they weren't challenging themselves through their collaborative talk, I think he was on their trails, yeah. Okay, I thought it was a highly effective 15, 16 minutes. I agree with the lady over there about body language. The quality of the mathematical talk, the quality of the mathematical reasoning, I thought was of a very high order. Certainly that mathematical language grew stronger in certain tables through the 15, 16 minutes. Children were substituting, they were factorising, they were expanding brackets, they were using some of them, quadratic formulae, they were rearranging formulae, they weren't getting it right the first time, some of them were arguing about an approach, some of them were checking to make sure why it was right, why it was wrong, and going back. Lots of reasoning, lots of justifying. I thought that was about as intense as a learning experience as it gets. And in terms of progress, by the end of that session, and taking your point, you know, it wasn't the end. There's going to be another one, and another one, and another one. But certainly, they were in full flow, and they continued. And what was really interesting, and you see some pretty contrived, and you see some pretty low-level, really, self-reflection in some lessons. They didn't have to write it down. They could have fed it back, not need any reflection necessarily. But the quality, by and large, of what they've written on those forms that they were given is quite impressive. It's quite impressive engaging their sort of general familiarity with an approach or a skill at the beginning, and how that had deepened or how their understanding had grown through application during the process. Yeah, so where does that leave us, ladies and gentlemen, in terms of the quality of that overall experience? The learners, we've said, who have been familiar with approaches and skills, who've started certainly to respond in a controlled manner, but all evidence points to the fact that this is one of the first occasions when they've been released to apply in a fairly open manner for such a length of time. And we've got virtually all the learners here intensely involved with high quality reasoning, and certainly not moving from a different approach or a different simultaneous equation, or everybody used at least more than one skill, certainly deepening their confidence in addressing similar approaches within a similar category. It's clearly not an inadequate experience, is it? And it's clearly not an experience that requires improvement. Every experience can be improved, but this is a quality learning experience. From what you've observed, what we've pieced together, certainly by the end of 37 minutes, and it's not the end of the learning journey. They're going to go on learning for a long, long time yet, and beyond this school. They are in a position that is definitely advanced, and I would say all of them are vis-a-vis approaches, skills, and some of them would move from simultaneous linear to thinking about linear and quadratics to some of the point of thinking about solving an equation with a linear and with a certain form as well. Does it matter? Does it matter? It's a high quality learning experience. Does it matter if it's a one or a two? We're obsessed with numbers. testing, I've got to have in my mind where there are shortfalls. And those shortfalls mustn't be personal. So I mustn't say, you know, it would have been even better had there been opportunity for more discussion or more self-reflection at the end, or the use of IT, or more interactive whiteboard, if all of those techniques wouldn't necessarily have enhanced the learning. I'm going to say it's outstanding, and doesn't mean to say that it's without a fault, but it doesn't mean to say really, in terms of the numbers, we've got almost all, if not all, of the learners, probably in the time available, going probably as far as they could, and as deep as they could. So that's where I am at the moment in time. I've also got some information that I could have asked for, and normally I would have had presented to me, that I'm a little short of. And whilst I know that the range of ability here is larger than Peter Estelle, I really want to know about the individuals a bit more. If you had a CT plan, I didn't ask for one, it wasn't given to me, that's absolutely fine. Or a set of photographs, just so I'm sure that the Estelles were pushed as far as they could go, and so forth, I'd feel even more confident in making that judgment between the one and the two. But as it is, ladies and gentlemen, I am going to make a judgment, because I know you're dying for me to make a judgment. And I honestly can't think of any single learner in that experience that wasn't pushed. I saw them all at various times contributing to discussion within an intensity of language, as I've said, using a range of skills, I've highlighted some of those skills, moving from calculation to calculation, testing themselves. This group said from the word go, okay, how much can we test ourselves to start with? They went straight into the middle, but they weren't even remotely interested in the lightweight. And that just tells me something about, and we come back to where we started, the climate of this group. They are together, aren't they? There is a certain bond with this teacher, I feel. The routines, the colleague mentioned earlier on, expectations are clear. Not just teach expectations as a group, but I also think group's expectations of each other, which is, I think, really important when you think about attitudes to learning. For a group of students of this number to maintain that intensity over that period of time, it's got to tell us a lot about, you know, the extent to which they're determined, they're keen, they're eager, they want to actually, you know, put themselves to the test. And, you know, all of that's going through my mind, and this is the science, but I can't think of how that experience, as it unfolded tonight, could be improved significantly. I would be rating that an exceptional experience, where I think learners have learned a great deal. And if they're getting that kind of experience on a regular basis, gosh, are they going to make exceptional progress over time? And of course, if I'd been able to see their books a little bit more,